Good morning, Cedar Park High School. It's Friday, September 25th, and it's an A-Day. I'm Ella Neal.
And I'm Abby Martinez.
On today's show, we have a story looking into how COVID-19 is impacting Friday Night Light traditions. And we highlight the return of a beloved CPHS tradition.
Plus, a new edition of the Pack Chat, and Luke Johnson and Katie Whitmarsh are in the studio for a game day sports report.
Plus, your pet of the week. Let's jump in because the Wolfcast starts now. COVID-19 has taken the world by shock. The elderly community is at risk. People are taking serious precautions and students are split between in-person and virtual learning.
The pandemic has left students in elective sports and music programs uncertain about what their seasons will look like. Many students can't help but wonder how those programs will continue throughout this year with ongoing regulations on our favorite high school activities.
COVID-19 has infected around 8,200 people in Williamson County. About 130 deaths have been reported, and the people are scared. Students all around the world are left wondering how and if their school days will continue.
I think for the community, you know, we just don't know. We are just hoping and praying that we get to do the things that we really enjoy being in Cedar Park.
This is a common thought among seniors and students throughout the school. Seniors are worried over how their last year of high school will happen and if their Friday Night Light experiences have been as good as other seniors who graduated prior COVID-19. Friday Night Lights is an iconic part of the high school experience, a time where students gather to cheer on the football team, watch the band perform a dynamic halftime show, chant along with the cries from cheerleaders, and move along to the routines from the celebs.
As a celebrity, football season is such an integral part of what we do, so the thought of not even getting that chance to, you know, put on the green glitter, put on the uniform, and perform is definitely heartbreaking. You know, we're always prepared, always planning in advance. But with COVID, you know, we're starting to play things by ear. I'm very proud of my team, officers and directors, for being able to adapt to the situation. And I'm excited to see what we can do.
Despite the challenges, students are still excited for whatever shred of Friday Night Light experience they can get, including senior quarterback Ryder Hernandez, who's glad to be back on the field. He says, "We're ready for the year to begin, and everyone is locked and loaded for a run at state." Another organization that is challenged is band. With the uncertainty of their football and competition season coming up, the band is unsure about how things will progress. Finding ways to play their instruments without putting each other at risk is another challenge. While COVID has impacted student life in many different ways, students are still making the best of the situation.
But I think that it's important, you know, for myself and, you know, seniors to you know, look on the bright side and, you know, appreciate the things that we do have currently rather than dwelling on the things we don't have. And I think if we all do our part, and, you know, adhering to guidelines and doing our part as citizens of this community, we can hopefully get a second semester.
The best thing we can do is keep our heads up and follow CDC guidelines.
Thank you for that report, Iliana.
I'm excited to see these programs finally take the field at tonight's game.
Even though COVID has made many changes in our school life, some traditions are meant to push through difficulties and keep going. One of these traditions is the drumline playing and walking through the hallways on Friday morning game days. Today, the drumline walked through the hallways, meeting up with the rest of the band in the courtyard to play pep rally music in honor of tonight's football game.
We know the teacher's been working really hard at the beginning of the school year and nothing's been normal, so we wanted to offer them an opportunity to hear the band around this time of year, which is one thing that is a little bit normal.
Great job, Timberwolf fans.
The Future Farmers of America, also known as FFA, are unsure on what to expect this year during the COVID-19 pandemic. To stay safe, their meetings are being held virtually. To limit contact, they have time slots to go to the farm and care for their animals, while also being required to wear masks and gloves. They still don't have the information on how the shows and competitions will be held.
Obviously going to be very upsetting because it is something that takes up a lot of my time and it's something that I enjoy. It's one of my passions, and so losing that extra time would be very upsetting, but I would rather waste a year than end up sick or putting other people in danger.
We will keep you updated on FFA and their future plans.
Up next, Madeline Roberts will catch up on the top three things you need to know for today.
Smoky Mo's Barbecue, the best barbecue that money can buy, proudly supporting Cedar Park High School.
Hi, I'm reporter Madeline Roberts with CPHS News, and here are your top three things that you need to know for today. First, President Trump's appearance at former Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg's lying in repose at the Supreme Court was met with boos from the crowd. The words "vote him out" could be heard as Trump and First Lady Melania stood briefly next to the flag-draped coffin before scurrying off to their limousine. Next, the founder of Austin-based Whole Foods, John Mackey, received backlash after stating in a New York Times interview when asked about companies offering better, healthier options to those who can't afford to shop at his stores, quote, "It's less about access and more about people making poor choices, mostly due to ignorance." Readers immediately retaliated online, many feeling that he's out of touch with the reality and expense of eating healthy in this country. Lastly, former One Direction star Zayn Malik and supermodel Gigi Hadid announced that they became parents over the weekend, welcoming their daughter into the world. Gigi announced the news with a photo on Instagram saying, quote, "Our girl turned his earth side this weekend, and she's already changed our world. So in love," end quote. And that's all I have for you today. With CPHS News, I'm Madeline Roberts. Have a fabulous Friday, Cedar Park.
Thanks, Madeline. Now we throw it over to Luke Johnson and Katie Whitmarsh for your sports report.
Hello, Cedar Park, and welcome to the first in-studio Wolfcast Sports Report. I'm Luke Johnson.
And I'm Katie Whitmarsh.
On Tuesday, the Cedar Park volleyball team played two games against Round Rock, Westwood, and Lake Travis.
That's right, Luke. And their game against the Westwood Warriors, the Lady Timberwolves did not hold back, winning three of their four sets.
This game's star was senior Avery Cole, who showed her true colors, putting up 14 kills, and not to mention senior Caitlin Davis with 16 digs.
Although the Lady Timberwolves lost against Lake Travis in three sets after the Westwood game, sophomore Dylan Gilkey was dishing dimes left and right.
Absolutely. Dylan finished with 15 assists, equally distributing her mastery of the skill across all three sets.
The team will travel to Westlake today at 6:30 to play the Chaps, so if you see them, wish them good luck.
Speaking of Westlake, I bet you guys want to hear how that Westlake scrimmage went on Friday. And fear not, the Black Rain came through with the dub, beating Westlake 28-24.
Oh yeah, but since this was just a scrimmage and not an official game, there were no officials, but numbers don't lie.
No they don't, Katie, because your Timberwolves doubled the opponent's rushing yard game with 121 rushing yards compared to Westlake's 68. Keep running, boys.
Expect them to bring this energy to our home opener today against Vandy at Gupton, with kickoff being at 7 o'clock.
These boys are hungry for a Vandegrift win ever since their last meeting, where we saw Vandy come out on top around the same time last year.
This will be for sure a game for the ages, so if you're attending, be safe and be ready to lose your voice by the morning.
That's all we have for you today. With CPHS News, I'm Luke Johnson.
And I'm Katie Whitmarsh.
Thanks, Luke and Katie. Up next is a new edition of the Pack Chat after this break.
We are not just here to share announcements. We are here to tell stories. Your stories. Students depend on us, and what they need from us is to be hype, to be ready, to be informed, to be successful, to be Timberwolves. We are real news. We are sideline reporters, moment captures, question askers, life sharers, cheers spreaders, and voice givers. And above all, we are students just like you, here to help you. We are journalism, newspaper, yearbook, and broadcast. We are CPHS News.
Welcome back to the Pack Chat, our student voice opinion segment. I'm joined today by my co-host Victor Martinez and Sam Mack, as well as our guest co-host John Pay, as we discuss this week's most trending topics. We would love to know what your thoughts are on today's topic, so head over to our Instagram at CPHS News. With that being said, let's get started. First, protests are breaking out in Louisville, Kentucky, as the grand jury decided to not charge any of the officers with the killing of Breonna Taylor. One of the officers, Brett Hankinson, was charged with wanton endangerment for firing bullets which landed in three neighbors' apartments the night of the shooting. Following a long night in Louisville, two police officers were shot. So, what do y'all think about the grand jury's decision, first of all? And then, second off, how do you think we're going to see this play out in, you know, the days to come, and even weeks, maybe?
honestly, I think when it came down to the trial, they should have took more time on it. I feel like they should definitely look better over it, because I feel like, because obviously I think that they should have been convicted personally. So I think they could have definitely taken more time in the trial and fight the protests and all that. I don't agree with officers being shot and all that, so I don't think that whole part of it's right. But when it comes to the trial, I feel like they definitely made some mistakes there.
Well, I don't think the trial should have been taking more time. The cops didn't do anything wrong. They were just doing their job. They were trying to catch a criminal inside Breonna Taylor's apartment. They had a no-knock warrant, but they knocked anyways. So they took special precautions, right? And the criminal fired back at them. So naturally,
The criminal was not in Breonna Taylor's apartment. He was in custody. So the criminal they were looking for was not even in the apartment and was already in custody at the time of the shooting. Kenneth Walker was not the criminal they were looking for. They were actually looking for Breonna Taylor's ex-boyfriend, who didn't live there anymore. And he was, once again, him and all of his accomplices were in custody at the time of the shooting.
And as well, even if they were looking for a criminal in that apartment, they were not in uniform. So from Kenneth Walker's perspective, he was looking at three intruders that were armed coming into his apartment, breaking into his apartment. Mm-hmm.
And I think that it can be concluded that when they did knock, I think, you know, if you look at the timeline of the case and whatnot, I think you can assume, you can tell based off of the timeline that they were probably asleep, dead asleep, at the time that the officers did knock and did identify themselves. But Kenneth Walker said that he did, once him and Breonna did wake up and they went into the hallway and they heard the knocking, he asked, "Who's there?" And he said that he did not get a reply. And so he went and got their handgun, which I'm sure both of you are pro Second Amendment. And Breonna went and put clothes on she was about to open the door, but they didn't have time to open the door before it was kicked down. And he didn't know who they were. They were in plain clothing. And he swears by the fact that he would not have even gotten the gun in the first place if he knew they were police officers. So you're right, Sam. I think that they could have definitely looked at this case a little closer and, you know, really gotten into it. Obviously, if the police officers were wearing body cameras, we'd know straight up. But, yeah, I think we're definitely going to see this in the news for weeks to come. Next, on September 18th, the Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, passed away. Now, with less than 40 days till the election, Republicans are calling on President Trump to appoint a new justice. Back in 2016, with 9 months left of Obama's last term, there was an opening on the Supreme Court. The Senate ruled it would only be fair for the new president to appoint the justice because it was an election year. Now, Republicans are going back on that statement. What do you guys think would be, you know, the fair thing to do here? Do you think that we should hold, you know, Mitch McConnell to his word, or do you think that we should fill that seat?
I think honestly, like in 2016, like what Mitch McConnell said is that when you, like the population of America, the citizens of America should have the opportunity to vote for and have an influence in who sits on the Supreme Court. And being that it is an election year, it should be treated as though that new opening on the Supreme Court is an opening that people get to vote for. They get to elect a president whose views align with theirs and who will select a Supreme Court justice who they think is going to back the Constitution fairly on that panel.
Yeah, for sure I agree. And I just think, I mean, the hypocrisy of them really pulling back on that statement. And in the video, he literally says, "Hold me to my word." And now we are, and it's like, they don't even care. And in fact, I mean, if you've read that Ruth Bader Ginsburg, she really, really wanted the new president to be able to appoint the member. And I think it is only fair, you know? I mean, it is an election. It's not to say that Trump won't be the one to appoint the new member. We're just asking for it to be after the election, you know?
Exactly.
Is that how you feel too, Sam? Or
I honestly think that's pretty fair. If, like, just to wait for the election then to vote for. Yeah. So I think that's kind of the right thing to do. Gives everyone, like, it's like a 50-50 chance on who gets elected. So I think that's pretty fair.
Wait, so what are y'all, like, implying that we should do about the new SCOTUS?
Like, we think that it should be the new president's responsibility to appoint a member since it's so close to the election.
Well, I mean...
Because that is what Mitch McConnell and Nate Obama do.
That Trump can win election. So, what, do we have 4 more years of vacancy? Because that's very dangerous.
No. It's not whether or not Trump should be the one to appoint him. It's just whether or not, would it be fair for Trump to do it now rather than wait till after the election? Because if, once again, just in Obama's last term, they wouldn't let him appoint a new member 9 months till the election because they said it's not fair to appoint a new justice during the election year when it's a big spot to fill since, you know, it's a lifelong position. So that, I think, is where...
Well, speaking from a partisan point of view, like, just leaving this where it is, leaving it as an even number is a very, like, dangerous thing.
It would only be an even number for 40 days is the thing. Yeah, but it's not like we're pushing it off so that way Trump will never be able to appoint a new member. It's just, it wouldn't be fair for him to appoint a new member this close to
the 2016, the vacancy lasted for much.
9 months. Yeah, the vacancy in 2016 lasted for 9 months. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I don't think, you know, they're really looking that much into it.
Well, what RBJ wanted was a new president, as in not Donald Trump.
She did want a new president, but I think that, you know, meant that wait till the election.
Yeah.
But finally.
It'd be very unfair, obviously, to wait until, like, 4 years after when Donald Trump is no longer president, if he were to be reelected. Like, obviously, I, like, don't agree with that. If he is reelected, he should choose the new SCOTUS. I just think that it's fair to wait until after the election so that the American people have a say in who's put on the Supreme Court.
For sure. Finally, Gigi Hadid and Zayn Malik welcomed their baby girl to the world yesterday. I don't know if y'all saw any TikToks or jokes about this, but, like, obviously Gigi Hadid is beautiful and Zayn Malik is as well. So there's, like, been a lot of jokes, like, circulating about, like, how pretty their baby is, like, going to be. And, like, I saw a TikTok that was, like, the picture that Zayn posted on Instagram. It's, like, just him holding, like, the baby's hands. But, like, her fingernails are perfect. And I saw a TikTok of some girl, and she was, like, tell me why those baby's hands are already prettier than me. And I kind of, I'm agreeing with that. How do y'all feel? Were y'all definitely were not fans of One Direction, were you? No.
I wasn't a huge fan, but I mean, I think everybody knew them. Everybody knew their music. Everybody, like, kind of was growing up. So it's, like, it's interesting to see, like, how, like, far they've gotten in life, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, that, like, makes three of them dads. I don't know if y'all know that. You know, I'm a bit in that rabbit hole, but...
I slept on the news. I didn't know this happened.
So. It's okay, John.
I don't listen to pop culture, like, anymore. So, yeah.
Well, that's all we have for today. For today's Pack Chat, thank you for tuning in. And remember, T-Wolf Pack, there's always time to chat.
Thanks, Pack Chat host. Now it's time for your Pet of the Week.
This is Simon, Meredith Jenkins' 2-year-old bearded dragon. His favorite food is mango, and he would eat mango all day if Meredith lets him. Simon loves to run around the room sniffing all the corners and exploring the house. Simon actually has a birth defect, which explains the little bulb near his tail. And at the end of the day, he loves to wind down and sleep in his owner's bed. That's all we have for today. Make sure you're keeping up with all of our content, so head over to our YouTube at CPHS News.
With CPHS News, I'm Abby Martinez.
And I'm Ella Neal. Remember to make it a great day or not. The choice is yours.